Rejoice and be glad in it. I invite you to direct your attention to the baptismal font, and as these waters are poured, to let you know that today's worship service is going to feel a little bit different. We're going to start with the loud shouts of Hosanna as our children enter, waving palms and singing. But pretty quickly, as we move through the service, it will pivot, and we will begin to move through the passion narrative of Christ. It's called Walking the Via Dolorosa. We're going to move from all that leads up to the entrance into Jerusalem all the way to the cross this day. So prepare for that sort of emotional ride as we walk this road together. With that said, I invite you to hear now this reading that comes from Luke's gospel.
After Jesus said this, he continued on ahead going up to Jerusalem. As Jesus came to Bethphage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives, he gave two disciples a task. He said, "Go to the village over there, and when you enter it, you will find tied up there a colt that no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks, 'Why are you untying it?' just say, 'Its master needs it.' Those who had been sent found it exactly as he had said. As they were untying the colt, its owner said to them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they replied, 'Its master needs it.' So they brought it to Jesus, threw their coats on the colt, and lifted Jesus onto it. As Jesus rode along, they spread their clothes on the road. As Jesus approached the road leading down the Mount of Olives, the whole throng of his disciples began rejoicing. They praised God with a loud voice because of all the mighty things they had seen. They said, 'Blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heavens.' Some of the Pharisees from the crowd said to Jesus, 'Teacher, scold your disciples. Tell them to stop.' He answered, 'I tell you, if they were silent, the stones would shout.'"
I invite you to remain standing for our opening song, "All Glory, Laud, and Honor."
Thank you.
How many of them know they're getting ready to Any and everybody wants to be a part of Lego Church is going to exit now, or you can return back to your seat with your family. Thanks be to God for all of our children, those who knew they were singing and those who found out they were singing when they got up here this morning. We are so grateful for their melodic voices this day. Let's take a moment to pray. Holy and gracious God, your grace has preceded us already into this space this day. We've shouted our loud hosannas, and we pray now that you would unstop our ears, that we might hear what you seek to say to us today, that you might make ready our hearts to receive this word. And we pray that we might prepare our souls, that this word would take root and bear fruit as we walk the Via Della Rosa this day, we pray. Amen. Some of you may be aware, but not all of you, that for the better part of 3 weeks, I was without a car. I was without a ride. It's a long story, and I won't bore you with all the details, but it has something to do with a blown cylinder head, if you know what that is, a leaking transmission pan, about waiting to get a warranty finally approved, parts shipped and brought in. Bottom line, I was without a ride for the better part of 3 weeks, and perhaps you don't realize it until it happens to you, but that wonderful old song lyric, "You don't know what you got till it's gone," played out very much so. Who would have guessed how disruptive it was to my own life and to our family's life, to the routine that we live in day by day? But before you shed any tears for us, don't worry, there were plenty of folks who came along and offered rides, and we're grateful for that. I owe them my endearing thanks for that. And I have to say that always and everywhere, no matter what, even if I thought I was in a jam, thought I didn't have a ride to get from A to B, at the last moment, someone came along and made sure I got where I needed to go. I bring it up because in our text for the morning, it's Jesus that is in need of a ride on this high, holy day. Jesus himself, and it's a ride not to work per se or to home, but a ride into Jerusalem. Richard Donovan reminds us that this is not Jesus' first time entering the capital city. It's not his first rodeo. He's been here many times before. His parents brought him, you remember, just days after he was born to the temple for his dedication. There's also that time when he was a teen when he ditched his parents, not to go out for a night on the town, but to read from the scroll in the temple. And it's likely that Jesus visited every year, just as all the other faithful did. And every time he visited, there were friends or extended family, someone who helped meet the family's needs for lodging and for transportation. But today, this moment is unlike any other day, unlike any previous visit. Jesus comes now not as a child, not as a teen, not just as a carpenter, and not just as the run-of-a-mill rabbi. Jesus comes not to sacrifice a lamb, but to be the sacrificial lamb, to atone for sin. Jesus comes as the King of Kings, the Prince of Peace. He comes in the name of the Lord. He comes to fulfill that prophecy first proclaimed by Zechariah. And Jesus comes with needs, as one who has many needs. Don't forget, he owns nothing, no material possessions save the robe that he's wearing, which Roman soldiers will soon gamble for in the wake of his death. Like his parents some 30 years back, when they entered Bethlehem and had no place to stay, Jesus here and now has no place to lay his sweet head. Throughout his ministry, he's been totally reliant on the generosity of others to meet his needs. Here and now, what he is in most of need of is a ride. So what does he do? Well, he sends two unnamed disciples ahead of him to go and get one. And I'm imagining that the two, when they learn this, are not thrilled that they've been assigned such a menial task. Go and secure a ride for you? Go and get a donkey? Not long ago, they were arguing over who was going to get to sit at his right hand, and now they're on donkey duty? Now they're attempting to line up transportation, a first century Uber for Jesus? Not only that, but notice not any old ride will do. Jesus is very specific about what he wants. No clunkers, no junkyard specials, nothing like my first car, a 1980 Thunderbird that I got in 1993. No, Jesus wants a brand new ride, one that's never been ridden before. Why? To fulfill that wonderful prophecy from Zechariah. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you triumphant and victorious, humble and riding on a donkey. Furthermore, why is Jesus entering on a donkey, on a colt? Why is he not on a wonderful steed, a powerful horse? Well, Alan Runnick in Lessons from a Donkey explains. To modern hearers like us, we view donkeys primarily as work animals, carrying heavy loads, or as rides for children at an amusement park. But in the ancient world, in the first century world of Jesus, donkeys were used for ceremonial purposes. They were ridden by a triumphant king returning from war. They were seen as symbols of peace. Jesus anticipates that these two disciples will meet some resistance. Not from the owners necessarily, but from bystanders. And there are critics in every crowd, aren't there? So he instructs them, if anyone says to you, why are you taking this colt, to respond back, the Lord has need of it. And sure enough, the scene plays out exactly as Jesus predicts. The two find the colt, they untie it, and they get questioned. Why are you taking this colt? And they respond back, the Lord has need of it. The Reverend Monica Gupart reminds us, however, that the scene could have played out differently. What if the owners of the colt said, no? What if they said, sorry, it's Passover, it's our busiest time of year, you can't have it. We have our own plans to take our offerings to the temple, and we need the donkey. Or what if they said, we can't take this level of risk, this donkey is our only source of income. And it's true, for most middle-class folks in the first century who were fortunate to be able to even own a donkey, this is their main source of income. This is not an insignificant ask that's being made of them to give up their donkey. Yet in this instance, the owners freely surrender their donkey, not even sure if they will ever see it again or get it back. Having successfully secured Jesus' ride, the two bring it back to the outskirts of Jerusalem, near Bethany, Bethpage. There, on the Mount of Olives, they quickly throw their cloaks on it, and you can just picture them trying to help Jesus swing that other leg on the other side to get ready to ride in. With Jesus securely mounted up, the parade procession begins. As the merry band makes its way, word begins to spread, and others race to join in, just like you saw children racing to join in to the parade today. Recognizing not only him, but also his ride. Remember, the donkey symbolizes peace and one of royalty who's coming. You can imagine their hopes and dreams beginning to soar as they see the Messiah entering on this donkey. They're beginning to throw down their cloaks and their palms, spreading them along the road ahead of Jesus. And it's worth acknowledging that this is quite the sacrifice for them too. It's likely few of them own more than one robe or cloak themselves, and once they throw it down and the donkey tramples over it, how good will it be for them going forward? And yet, caught up in the moment, they throw it down. They begin to shout, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." And we can imagine their heads filling not with visions of sugar plums dancing, but with this one who's coming, who might finally overthrow Rome, who might end the occupation of their land, who might bring peace and tranquility and prosperity for them. However, if you've read ahead in this narrative, or as you will soon see as we move through the liturgy, ironically and tragically enough, the one who enters this day in peace, humble and riding on a donkey, will all too soon be met with violence and death. Yet knowing full well by this point how the story will end for him, Jesus rides on. He doesn't abandon the mission because ultimately he's come to meet our need to be atoned for our sin. In the end, one can't help but wonder if the owners of the donkey will ever fully grasp the gift they've given to Jesus. Same with the unto named disciples. Will they ever understand that it wasn't a menial task to go get that donkey, but was mission critical to Jesus' work? And finally, to point out all the other ways that Jesus' needs are met in this story and in the days ahead. For soon he'll be in need of a guest room to celebrate the Last Supper. He'll be in need of burial spices to properly prepare his body for burial. He'll need an unused tomb to lay his body after his crucifixion. All of these needs are met again and again by the faithful. It repeats a pattern that's been true throughout all of the Gospels, is it not? Anytime Jesus has had a need, it's been met. He needed water jugs so wine could be resupplied. He needed a boat to be able to put out from the shore to preach and teach. He needed 5 loaves and 2 fish to feed thousands of hungry souls. And whether it was expensive extravagant or the simple offering of a bag lunch, the need was made known and the need was met. At the end of the day, the owners of the donkey, the cloaks, the upper room, the empty tomb, all have something the Lord has need of, and all freely, willingly surrender it. They don't resist, and look what happens as a result. We can only imagine the joy and the fulfillment they find in participating in this unfolding drama. Well, flash forward to here and now, and the reality remains in our community and beyond, there remain a great number of needs, both within the life of this church and beyond it. The need to continue to form our children, who you saw beautifully singing this morning, and our youth, to be all whom God dreams them to be. The need to continue to offer adults ongoing, soul-sustaining spiritual formation. The need to continue to offer glorifying worship, God-glorifying worship, to care for souls, to address needs of hunger and housing in this community and beyond, and the needs unfold before us. But let us not forget what we've learned, what we've been reminded, and our children just saying as we move through Lent and this story about Zacchaeus that unfolded over those 4 weeks, that fleecing one's neighbors in order to accumulate possessions for oneself, to accommodate one's needs, not wants, wants more over than needs, leads us not into right relationship, but rather up a tree without a ladder, a place of deep discontent. But thanks be to God, we're not left there. We're not hung out to dry. We're not up on that limb without a ladder. Rather, the Lord passes by, invites himself over, and reminds us that he's met our every need, our need for daily bread, our need to move in a new direction, our need for new investments of our time and talent and treasure, our need for salvation. And I hope and pray, as we've come to understand over this 40-day journey, is that we are mightily blessed. Honestly, upon deep reflection, I can't name a time in my life when a need has not been met. As we reflected on early in the series, I've been reminded I am truly rich. A roof over my head, a place to sleep, food to eat, access to care. I am truly richer than the vast majority of those who walk the planet Earth at this same moment. I have much, much to be thankful for. And so now, as we move into this moment and move forward together as the people of God, and together today as those who are part of the life of this church, prepare to bring our commitment cards forward and to place them in these baskets. The moment is for me to pray over how will I respond to this need. I pray that I'll respond, and I pray that you will respond along with me, like the owners of the donkey and the cloaks and the upper room and the tomb, and that when I hear the Lord has need of it, that we will generously respond, because the reality is the Lord has met our needs, and now the Lord has need of us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.
Not long after Christ enters into the city, greeted with loud hosannas and blessing, Judas, one of his own disciples, sets about the work of betraying him. So we hear now from the Gospel of Matthew. When Jesus finished speaking all of these words, he said to his disciples, "You know that the Passover is 2 days from now, and the human one will be handed over to be crucified. Then the chief priests and elders of the people gathered in the courtyard of Caiaphas, the high priest. They were plotting to arrest Jesus by cunning tricks and to kill him. But they agreed that it shouldn't happen during the feast, so that there wouldn't be an uproar among the people." Then one of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said, "What will you give me if I turn Jesus over to you?" They paid him 30 pieces of silver. From that time on, he was looking for an opportunity to turn him in. But Judas is not the only one who betrays Christ. In fact, all throughout this next week, we will hear story upon story about how disciples who pledge their allegiance and their loyalty also turn their back on Christ himself. And if we're honest, we also betray Jesus Christ. Maybe not in the huge, over-the-top ways that the disciples do this week, but in our own small, day-to-day ways. So it's important now that we take a moment to confess our own betrayals. Let us pray together using our prayer of confession, which can be found in our bulletin and also up on the screen. Holy God, sure of your faithfulness even in your dying, comforted by your compassion toward your people in every age, we beg for your mercy on our imperfect solitude. We have looked to you for paltry favors. When you have given everything, we have withheld from your people, our neighbors, and from your creation, our earth, the care and tending they deserve. We have rejected the cornerstone that you sent to build a people of righteousness, even here today. Forgive our failings, heal what we have broken, nurture what we have neglected, and lead us to your vision so that we may know the peace of wholeness in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Having confessed corporately, we now offer our individual confession in silence. Amen. And friends, hear this good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. As we prepare to receive our offering this day, those of you who have been here the last couple of weeks know that we are at our Commitment Sunday following the end of our generosity campaign, and you might have brought with you your commitment cards. We're going to ask that you hold those because there will be an opportunity for you to bring those down with you when we do communion. If you forgot it and would like to fill one out, there should be some on the inside edges of the pews. If you're a visitor among us today, we're just so glad that you're here. And we hope that this is a wonderful time of preparation for Holy Week. Friends, let us pray as we prepare to receive our offering. Generous God, for the week we are about to traverse, we give you thanks. We thank you for the witness of Jesus Christ, who gave everything, not just his life, but also his whole being to us as a model for the ways in which we should give ourselves to others. We ask that you would take these gifts and you'd multiply them so that all around the world would know your love for them. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus and said, "Where do you want us to prepare the feast for you to eat the Passover meal?" He replied, "Go into the city to a certain man and say, 'The teacher says my time is near. I'm going to celebrate the Passover with my disciples at your house.'" The disciples did just as Jesus instructed them, and they prepared the Passover. That evening, amid all the joy and the cacophony, he took his place at the table with the 12 disciples. And as they were eating, he said, "I assure you that one of you will betray me." Deeply saddened, each one of them said to him, "I'm not the one, am I, Lord?" And he replied, "The one who will betray me is the one who dips his hand with me into this bowl. Christ goes to his death just as it is written about him. But how terrible is it for that person who betrays the human one? It would have been better for him if he had never been born." Now Judas, who would betray him, replied, "It's not me, is it, Rabbi?" Jesus answered, "You said it." While they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body." He took a cup, gave thanks, gave it to them, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many, so that their sins may be forgiven." And so it is, we remember that Jesus gathered on that night with his disciples, with those whom he knew who would betray him. He took bread, he gave thanks, he broke it, and he shared it. "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this often in remembrance of me." And in a similar fashion, when the meal was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, and shared it. "Drink from this, all of you, for this is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Drink from this often in remembrance of me." And so we pray, Almighty God, that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and of wine, that you would make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. And all of God's people said, Amen. Today you're going to be invited to come and to receive Holy Communion. The ushers will give you direction to come by way of the center aisle or by the side aisle when it's your turn. As you come forward, there are prepackaged communion elements available. You can pick one of those up and take it back to your seat. Also, there's two stations here where pastors will be located. We'll take a piece of the bread, dip it into the cup, and hand it to you to commune. And as you come forward, if you have your estimate of giving card, we invite you to place it in the basket on either side. As we make our final preparations, I invite our ushers to move into place. Come and receive.
Grace, how sweet the sound. Worthy.
Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant, as we prepare to go into the world to give ourselves for others, that we might go so in the strength of your Spirit, we pray. Amen.
When the supper is over, Jesus leads Peter, James, and John and his disciples out of the upper room to a nearby garden to pray. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he wrestles with the call to surrender his life. So let us join him now in the garden as he prays. From Matthew. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to the disciples, "Stay here while I go and pray over there." When he took Peter and Zebedee's two sons, he began to feel sad and anxious. Then he said to them, "I am very sad. It is as if I am dying. Stay here and keep alert with me." And then he went a short distance further and fell on his face and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, take this cup of suffering away from me. However, not what I want, but what you want." He came back to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "Couldn't you stay alert 1 hour with me? Stay alert and pray so you won't give in to temptation. The spirit is eager, but the flesh is weak." A second time he went away and prayed, "Father, if it is not possible that this cup be taken away unless I drink it, then let it be what you want." Again he came and found them sleeping. Their eyes were heavy with sleep. But he left them and again went and prayed the same words for a third time. Then he came to his disciples and said to them, "Will you sleep and rest all night? Look, the time has come for the human one to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let's go. Look, here comes my betrayer." Jesus is wrestling with God's will for his life. Judas Iscariot returns, this time with the authorities to arrest Jesus. They come bearing swords and clubs. It's like something out of a mob scene in a movie. So we watch now as Christ is betrayed and arrested by one of his own. While Jesus was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, came. With him was a large crowd carrying swords and clubs. They had been sent by the chief priests and elders of the people. His betrayer had given them a sign, "Arrest the man I kiss." And just then he came to Jesus and said, "Hello, Rabbi." And then he kissed him. But Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you came to do." And then they came and grabbed Jesus and arrested him. One of those with Jesus reached for his sword. Striking the high priest's slave, he cut off his ear. And then Jesus said to him, "Put the sword back into its place. All those who use the sword will die by the sword. Or do you think that I'm not able to ask my Father, and he will send me more than 12 battle groups of angels right away? But if I did that, how would the scriptures be fulfilled to say that this must happen?" And then Jesus said to the crowds, "Have you come with swords and clubs to arrest me like a thief? Day after day I sat in the temple teaching, but you didn't arrest me. But all this has happened so that what the prophet said in the scriptures might be fulfilled." And then all of the disciples left Jesus and ran away. Jesus was arraigned and put on trial. He's brought before the Roman governor, Pontius Pilate. So we listen now as Christ goes on trial. What will be the verdict? Early in the morning, all the chief priests and elders of the people reached the decision to have Jesus put to death. They bound him, led him away, and turned him over to Pilate, the governor. Jesus was brought before the governor. The governor said, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus replied, "That's what you say." But he didn't answer when the chief priests and elders accused him. Then Pilate said, "Don't you hear the testimony they bring against you?" But he didn't answer, not even a single word. So the governor was greatly amazed. It was customary during the festival for the governor to release to the crowd one prisoner, whomever they might choose. At that time, there was a well-known prisoner named Jesus Barabbas. When the crowd had come together, Pilate asked them, "Whom would you like me to release to you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called Christ?" He knew that the leaders of the people had handed him over because of jealousy. While he was serving as judge, his wife sent this message to him: "Leave that righteous man alone. I've suffered much today in a dream because of him." But the chief priests and elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and kill Jesus. And the governor said, "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" "Barabbas," they replied. Pilate said, "Then what should I do with Jesus who is called Christ?" And they said, "Crucify him." But he said, "Why? What wrong has he done?" And they shouted even louder, "Crucify him." Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere and that a riot was starting. So he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood," he said. "It's your problem." All the people replied, "Let his blood be on us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus whipped and then handed him over to be crucified.
After sentencing Jesus to death, Pilate hands the condemned over to his soldiers. They lead Jesus into the governor's headquarters, where they strip him. They put a scarlet robe on him. They fashion a crown of thorns and place it on his head. They put a reed in his hand. They kneel down in front of Jesus and mock him. Afterwards, they strip him down, put his own clothes back on him, and lead him away to be crucified. Walk with Jesus now as he is led to the cross. As they were going out, they found Simon, a man from Cyrene. They forced him to carry the cross. And when they came to the place called Golgotha, which means skull place, they gave Jesus wine mixed with vinegar to drink. But after tasting it, he didn't want to drink it. And after they crucified him, they divided up his clothes among them by drawing lots. They sat there guarding him. They placed above his head the charge against him. It read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." It was now about noon, and darkness covered the whole earth until about 3 o'clock, while the sun stopped shining. Then the curtain in the sanctuary tore down the middle, And crying out in a loud voice, Jesus said, "Father, into your hands I entrust my life." And after he said this, he breathed for the last time. And now we come to this moment as we walk with Joseph of Arimathea as he places Jesus' body in the tomb. That evening, a man named Joseph came. He was a rich man from Arimathea who had become a disciple of Jesus. He came to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. And Pilate gave it to him, gave him permission to take it. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and laid it in its own new tomb, which he had carved out of the rock. And after, he rolled a large stone at the door of the tomb and went away. I invite you now to stand as you're able for our closing hymn, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." We'll sing verse 1 together.
Thank you.
forth into the day, a reminder that we have our Easter egg hunt today up at 4 o'clock on the Southern Village Green. Last count I heard, we were north of 1,600 eggs. So I hope our children will come and have an opportunity to help us find all of those eggs that will be hidden. As we move into the week, a reminder, Tuesday morning, we have our men's gathering at 8:30 over in Building 103. Thursday night at 6 o'clock will be a meal experience for Maundy Thursday in Ascension Hall. Good Friday from noon to 3, Stations of the Cross will be displayed in this space, and then we'll gather at 7 o'clock for our service of tenebrae, where we'll be extinguishing the light and reading through the Passion of Christ. On Easter Sunday morning, we'll gather at 7 o'clock, and this morning I noted at 7 o'clock, still pretty dark outside. We'll gather at 7 o'clock up on the green, 9 and 11 in this space, and a 10 o'clock service outside on the green as well. Thank you to all of our wonderful musicians today for all the beautiful music that you offered us. What an incredible gift. And for our children who made our Palm Sunday parade unforgettable, we are grateful. As we go into this week, I hope we will walk, pay attention, and notice that even amidst of the brokenness and the pain and the suffering, God's grace goes with us. Go in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.